Welcome back. And I'm going to be looking at filter design. I'm not going to present you with a pile of equations on filter design, of course. That would take far too long and quite a series of lectures. But I'm going to be looking at some software instead. Before I do that, let's just have a quick look and remind ourselves about filter design and some of the terms involved. Otherwise, it can be a bit confusing. So, if we're designing a low pass filter, there's no such thing as an ideal low pass filter. There's the red line there. This is on the MATLAB help page. The reason you can't get a vertical line like that just to cut off all frequencies is because it would be uncausal. If you take the inverse Fourier transform of that, you get to a sinc function in the time domain, which requires negative time. So it's not possible. So we have a finite width here. So this is the pass band here, along here, this bit here. This is the stop band. So this is when you cut off everything down here. And in the middle is the transition band. And obviously, the more steep you want this, the more attenuation you want here at the high frequencies means the steeper this is going to be in the transition, which means the higher the order of the filter. And because these are designed on polynomials, you end up with some kind of either a ripple here or a sort of loss in the passband. The Butterworth filter doesn't gives us a nice flat response, but it sort of droops down by the end, and it's called the passband ripple. And there's also can be stopband ripple as well, depending on the type of filter. And there's a whole range of pluses and minuses about what type of filters to use and so on, depending on the applications. So I'm going to look at this piece of software here, which is the Newhertz Technologies Filter Solutions 2020, kindly donated by the company to myself and AUT. We've got 32 licenses. And I'm going to show you how to design a simple filter. Let's supposing we wanted to have a low pass filter at one. I'm going to make it low pass to begin with anyway. Have a low pass filter at a cutoff of 1 kilohertz. We put in, see, it goes up to gigahertz, this one. So 1 kilohertz, just going to type that in there. I'm going to make it an active filter. Now, let's supposing I haven't actually, well, it said fifth order here, but I haven't set the order. Let's put in an order, stop band attenuation. Let's just put 40 dB of attenuation, and we'll put the stop band frequency at 10 kilohertz. So this is the pass band frequency here, and this is a stop band frequency. So that's 1 kilohertz, so that's 10 kilohertz. So it would have come down by 40 dB in that during the transition here. So if I set that, it's telling me I only need a second order filter, okay, to do that, which makes sense because it's 40 dB in 1 decade, 1 kilohertz to 10 kilohertz is the slope. So maybe I can do a bit better than that. Let's make it 60 dB. Okay, so it's saying now I need third order. So now, if I didn't want to do that, I could just specify an order. I could put any order. I could put eighth order or whatever I like, really. And I don't have to design it this way. So I've got my design active filters. I'm going to do a frequency response. I'm going to set the board plot from 10 hertz up to, I don't need gigahertz there, 20 kilohertz, let's see. Or no, make it 100 kilohertz. And it's going to be low pass, and I'm going to make it Butterworth. We've got all this selection, Chebyshev-1, Chebyshev-2. These are the most common ones, the elliptic and the Bessel. I'm going to do an analog one, of course, to begin with. Let's just look at the frequency response. And it does give us a whole range of things from the group delay to the magnitude and phase. I'm just going to look at the magnitude to begin with. And we see that it's got a cutoff of 1 kilohertz, very flat, of course, as we'd expect. And it's third order, should have a slope of minus 60 dB. There's 60 dB. And it's a decade is from 1 kilohertz, so 10 kilohertz. So it's given us the right type of filter. But the way this package differs from just MATLAB, I mean, in MATLAB we can do something similar, is it does physical realization. So if I click on Salin and Key, then I can just do synthesize filter, and there it is. It gives me a Salin Key filter realization, complete with the component values, which is quite amazing, really. And even a net, I think you can simulate that as well in SPICE. Now I can get a better version. It can absorb the first orders, synthesize the filter, and there we go. It's all put into one op amp. Now this T section here is rather neat. It gives you a good idea of how to design decent filters as well. We don't have to use the Salin and Key method. We can use the multiple feedback approach. Let's not absorb the first orders first. Those of you that have studied the multiple feedback filter, this one here, and this is just an extra first order stuck on the front. But you can absorb those two together, synthesize the filter, and it's still giving us two op amps anyway. The second one's just like a buffer anyway. I'm not sure it's entirely necessary. But if you wanted to add extra gain, let's put a gain of 100 on the end of it. I think that's what that extra op amp is. Nope, it's not. It's still left it as a unity gain buffer. Anyway, there's our filter. Let's go back to, let's just put a gain of 10 or something like that. And we can change resistor values and so on here if we want to. Let's now take our Chebyshev filter and let's make the order much higher. Let's make it, I'm just going to specify it to be a 8th order filter from 1 kilohertz. And there it is there. You can see this slight bend here. This is where it differs. All 8th order filters are going to have a slope of minus 20 times 8, which is minus 160 dB per decade. So there's 1 kHz and 10 kHz. You'll probably find that should be around 160 dB per decade. And they should all asymptotically go to that anyway. But during the transition frequency, this one kind of bends a little bit before it goes flat. So that's an 8th order one. Why you'd want that, I don't know, because it's got ripple in the passband, but there may be an application where you get slightly better attenuation and you put up with the ripple in the passband. Let's look at the Salin Key. Absorb second orders this time. So if I just leave it at the moment the way it is, it's going to give me everything in second order filters. 2, 4, 6, 8, you see. So it's given me an 8th order. Now obviously that's very wasteful in circuitry and it introduces extra noise and so on. So if I absorb the second orders, it gives me the whole solution in 2 op amps, which is rather nice actually. Quite a complicated solution. You can get a that's the I think that's for SPICE simulation, and we can also get list of components somewhere as well. Can't remember where it is, but anyway. Oh, the transfer function, I forgot. So just like in MATLAB, it would give us a transfer function. And if I wanted to put this into MATLAB, I can, well, there's a couple of ways I can copy. And I think that does it. Well, no, that just copies the graph, I think. Sorry, vectors. That's better. Copy numerator and denominator. Let's go into MATLAB. Oh, that's the MATLAB here. So the numerator is... where's the denominator? Right. So copy numerator, denominator. go into MATLAB, paste. Ah, the numerator is 2.06 times 10 to the 29, and these are the denominator, and it puts it in the really nice a nice way that you know, you can define the transfer function. So I can do like G equals TF num comma denom, and there's the transfer function. And then I can, in MATLAB, I can do my own board plot if I want to, board of G. It should be there somewhere. I can put in a grid. And so there's my own board plot in MATLAB. And I can obviously do things with that then in MATLAB if I want to. It's just kind of nice. So the other things I can do. So that's the Chebyshev. Butterworth won't have any, doesn't have as much attenuation in the transition band. Let's look at its frequency response. And it's much sort of more ordinary. There's the phase. This is the phase is folding here, so it actually keeps going down, but it's just a lot of software does that. It wraps it around. It's called phase wrapping. It wraps it back up again, so you can see it all, and otherwise the graph goes all the way down to nothing at all. Group delay tells you how linear it is, really, and there's this peak here. But it's an analog filter, so you can't expect much else. The nearest you'll get, if you want linearity in the phase, would be a Bessel filter. And we can have a look at the frequency response of that. And that group delay should be a little bit better, as we see. It's flat there to the cutoff, at least, and then it rolls off. There's no peaks in that. Chebyshev 2 is interesting. That's got ripple in the stop band, as you'll see here. Let's get rid of the other stuff. Group delay. It's group delay, linear phase wise, it's pretty terrible. It's certainly at the end here of the high frequencies. You want the group delay to be fairly constant, by the way. So here the Chebyshev 2, and it's got ripple in the stop band. If you're wondering how it can get that, well, it's actually got it's got zeros. That's how it manages to get that. So it's not an all-pole filter. So it's eighth order denominator, sixth order numerator, and again we can copy the numerator terms and denominator terms. Somehow, anyway, that when I do copy, I know it copies it in anyway, because I've just done that. The Salen key, of course, in multiple feedback isn't the only solutions. We can have these kind of state space type approaches, and that's something I would do. It's like state variable filters, quite complicated, as you can see. Is another way to do to implement these filters. That's a Chebyshev, of course. I should have pointed out as well, the elliptic gives us the most attenuation of all, but it gives us a really nasty, there's actually ripple in the passband. This is perhaps a bit unrealistic, this passband ripple here. The ripple normally we make 3 dB. I just default it to that. Let's make it 3 dB, and now you see that there's a ripple in the passband and a ripple in the stop band, but it's a very sharp transition. That's an elliptical filter. Just quickly go back to Chebyshev 1, and it's got ripple now because the passband ripple I've specified as being higher. And I can make that anything I like as well. It all depends on the order and so on that I want. I can do distributed filters. This is passive filters. I think I can synthesize a filter. Oh, well, that's a distributed, looks like a distributed filter. That's not what I want. I want a lumped parameter one. Yeah, so this gives us passive filters in terms of inductors and capacitors. For certain applications that don't need op amps, that's the also physically realizes that. And for those of you that understand distributed filters, it's not a subject I'm really into. It's more like for strip lines for RF design and so on. It'll design you that as well. It's really important stuff. The other thing I'm interested in is digital filters. Let's go to a simpler, let's just go to a second order filter with a 3 dB passband and 1 kHz cutoff Butterworth. And let's do a digital filter now. I'm going to use the bilinear transform. The bilinear transform is going to, I don't really need a 10 gigahertz sample rate. So 1 kilohertz, I'm going to make it 10 kilohertz sample rate. And it's an IIR filter. That is frequency pre-warping. One of the things about the bilinear transform is that it can distort the frequency slightly if you don't sample high enough. But here I'm sampling pretty high enough. I'm not going to do this pre-warping thing. There's my frequency response. It's again, I'm going to get rid of the thing. It's a digital response here. So you actually see the other frequencies, the negative frequencies, I think somewhere will appear. There's my cutoff at 1 kilohertz. And the filter, there it is, a transfer function. Second order over second order in the Z domain this time. And you can do all sorts of other things with finite arithmetic and so on. It'll even give you the code in C, you know, sort of sample code. This is defining the numerator coefficients down here, denominator coefficients here, and this is the convolution part down here. Okay. So if you don't want to write your own code, you can do that. So that's an IR filter. If you put pre-warping into it, it shouldn't really make a huge amount of difference here because the cutoff is still at 1 kilohertz, whichever whether I use, because I'm sampling at quite a high frequency, 10 times higher than the highest frequency of interest. Now if I want an FIR filter, finite impulse response, that is, the other one was infinite impulse response, then let's see a Hanning window, see if it can do me that frequency response. There it is, and very flat, and it's down 60 dB in the, well, even more over here, and it'll give me the filter transfer, the Z transfer function. It's a 200th order one, it seems to default to. These are the coefficients, or the weights, if you like, of the filter. And again, we can copy them as well. If we put them in a vector form, we can then copy them into MATLAB and use them in MATLAB. The other thing is there's pole zero plots. That's the, I think that's the unit circle here, the in the Z domain. Make it, you've got to be careful so it looks like a circle, it looks like an ellipse there, so you make it square. So that's the zeros, they're all zeros. Poles at the origin, 199 poles at Z equals zero, because it's an FIR filter, and these are the zeros of the filter. And really, it also does step response as well. If we go back to active filters, you can also, this is a second order filter, Butterworth, multiple feedback, but let's look, that's its frequency response, second order, standard second order. We can look at its transfer function. That's the Butterworth. It would have been found from the Butterworth polynomial. It's not the Butterworth polynomial for second order is s squared plus root 2s plus 1, but then you do a transformation low pass to low pass, and that for the particular cutoff that you require. So the prototype, it's called, is got the prototype per polynomial root 2 pole 0 plots. Second order has just got two complex conjugate poles. And I think, well, of course, we can do bandpass filter if we want to. And we can set us, I suppose we want a center frequency of 1 kHz with a pass band of, let's make it, so does it set the order? Stop band attenuation, that. Oh, can't do that, right? Center frequency 1 kHz. Let's make the pass band frequency 100 Hz. So it's going to be 100 Hz thing. Let's increase the order to 4, 5, 6, 7, 8th order. Be a lot of circuitry there. So it's an 8th order Butterworth bandpass filter centered at 1 kHz with 100 Hz. 100 Hz bandwidth. There it is. The phase should be transition straight down, like a step response almost. The physical realization with Sal and Key be quite complicated. An 8th order. Oh, it's going on. Yes, there is a numerator term, of course, because it's 8th order. Oh, that's the wrong one. It's a transfer function I want. Should have an s to the power 8 on the numerator here, and 16th order on the denominator, because it has to go up and then down again, because it's a bandpass filter. If I absorb the second order terms and synthesize it again with a Sal and Key, I can get a much smaller filter. So let's see if we can get it. It's still pretty complicated though, and you can see why you try to avoid such filters if you can, and why there's been a move to digital filters, of course, in the last 30 years or so. Certain things like anti-aliasing filters, of course, have got to be analog. You can't get around that. And once you get to very high frequencies and RF, this is where it's the analog stuff comes back into play again. Okay, so that's the basic idea. Filter Solutions, if you want to buy it, great little program. You can get academic discount as well. Thank you.